With book pages shrinking in most newspapers, the old lady of Dalier Street is putting her money where her mouth is, investing in Irish and international writers. Since 1989, a growing number of publishers in England and America have come to see the Irish Times prizes as a singular way of celebrating good writing. The prizes are made in four categories: Irish literature fiction, non-fiction and poetry, and international fiction. First, international jury chairman and former literary editor of the Los Angeles Times, Jack Miles.
This being an international jury, there is always one American judge, one English judge, and one Irish judge. So you have the experience of observing and in action three different sensibilities operating in the same language. In this particular year, we had, I think, a pretty outstanding group of nominees, but this also happens to be the first year that the winner of the International Fiction Award is an Irish writer. And that is to discharge one of the original functions set up by the Irish Times in creating this award, which was that Irish novelists and short story writers would be able to measure themselves against the best international competition.
There is a sense in the literary community in the world that these prizes are about good writing, and that what is being celebrated is good writing. And there isn't any kind of newspaper hype or anything that's about personalities. It's simply about good readers finding the best books. And I don't want to say it's respectable, because that makes it sound boring, but it is a deeply respected prize. It means something to have won it.
Pat Boren, you're a poet. Who are these awards important for? Are they more important for the sponsor or for the writer, do you think?
I suppose a little bit of both. It's kind of a symbiotic relationship. The paper looks good, or a paper looks good, to be behind literature. And it's good for a writer, more for publicity, I would say, than for the actual amount of money, when you consider that the size of a prize like this is more or less equivalent to an Arts Council bursary. But also, of course, a prize like this is an extension of the system of patronage that existed before the state got in behind writers. And I think that's important to remember as well. It's something that's unofficial, if you like.
And what about readers? Does it give anybody an indication that this is actually a book worth buying?
Yeah, well, I think there's an awful lot of stuff being published all the time, and this acts as a sort of a filtration system which would aim you towards maybe a new writer on the scene or whatever, something that where you might agree or disagree about the quality, but at least it kind of cuts down on the choice.
Let's move on to fiction. Jack Miles' international jury read through four shortlisted books: A Fine Balance by Rowanton Mystery, The Blue Flower by Penelope Fitzgerald, and two Northern Ireland writers, Robert McLean Wilson and Seamus Dean. Dean was also shortlisted by A.S. Byatt's jury for the Irish Fiction Prize, and so was Robert McLean Wilson's Eureka Street, along with William Trevor's collection of short stories, After Rain. And for the first time, both prizes go to the same writer. The winner is Seamus Dean for a gripping novel set in the Derry of his childhood, Reading in the Dark.
Love laughs at a king. Kings don't mean a thing.
On the street of dreams,
dreams broken in two can be made like new. On the street of dreams.
Stairs, February 1945. On the stairs there was a clear, plain silence. It was a short staircase, 14 steps in all, covered in lino from which the original pattern had been polished away to the point where it had the look of a faint memory. 11 steps took you to the turn of the stairs with the cathedral and the sky always hung in the window frame. 3 more steps took you onto the landing, about 6 feet long. "Don't move," my mother said from the landing. "Don't cross that window." I was on the 10th step, she was on the landing. I could have touched her. "There's something there between us, a shadow. Don't move." I had no intention. I was enthralled. But I could see no shadow. "There's somebody there, somebody unhappy. Go back down the stairs, son."
What Seamus Dean did, I think, was take something that perhaps comes from a world we've all been to. The epigraph to this book is, "The people were saying no two were e'er wed, but one had a sorrow that never was said." if there's a universal human experience, it is the experience of the sorrow that never was said, and the ways in which kindness can lead to silence, and silence can lead to destruction.
I went down, excited, and sat at the range with its red heart fire and black lead dust. We were haunted. We had a ghost, even in the middle of the afternoon. I heard her moving upstairs. The house was all cobweb tremors. No matter where I walked, it yielded before me and settled behind me. She came down after a bit, looking white. Do you see anything? No, nothing, nothing at all. It's just her old mother with her nerves, all imagination.
Just as it's emotionally strong, it's artistically beautiful. Everything is clear cut. There is no redundant sentence. There is no redundant scene. If you reread it, you see all sorts of things in the early parts of the narrative which you only understand once you've read the end of the narrative.
He presents the child's progressive discovery of what has gone wrong and why people are keeping silence at such dreadful cost to themselves in the language of a poet. I mean, what won us, what won me, I'll speak more personally, was the dazzling language of this novel. There's really nothing like it I've read in years.
Eddie, November 1947. It was a fierce winter that year. The snow covered the air raid shelters at night. From the stair window, the field was a white paradise of loneliness, and a starlit wind made the glass shake like loose black water and the ice snore on the sill while we slept and the shadow watched. There's a good deal of autobiography in it, but as you witnessed yourself this morning, was it, when you were looking for my sister Una's grave, you met Una rather than her grave. So there's an autobiographical base and then some variation upon that. In effect, it's two family histories conflated into one sort of parable history of what it was like to grow up in this city and in this province in the 40s and 50s.
Imagination is funny.
Is that you in the cover of the book? Is that really
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I was easily recognizable. I was a bald one.
You were the bald one?
Yeah, he's the guy with the hair.
He's the good looking one, isn't he?
Imagination is crazy.
I remember the importance of Brook Park Library for me as a kid, especially in those days when we played football up in Rosemount, and then came from Rosemount back through the park, and very often I would nip in there, starting at the children's section and finally working my way up to what I remember was a very fine collection of American fiction that for some reason happened to be in Brook Park at that time. It was not only a pleasure to open it, but yeah, I could sense the how emblematic it was that the first visit, not of course wasn't the first visit back to Derry, but back to this street, to the Craig, and to the whole if you like, commemoration of the place should be centered around a library, and especially centered around a library in a place which for so long had been deprived of it. All the while I was saying her name over and over, Una, 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 Una. It was dark and I felt contrite and lonely, fearful as well. I have to go, I said to the ground. I have to go. I don't like leaving you, but I have to go, Una. The wall seemed far away. I got up off my knees and rubbed my hands in my socks. I'll come back soon. I set off at a run along the dark pathway, zigzagging round headstones and great glass bells of airless flowers, Celtic crosses, raised statues, lonely bare plots, another even fresher grave.
One of those books, rather like Toni Morrison's Beloved, which tells you something terrible, and yet at the end of it you feel elated because he has managed to tell you something terrible in such an extraordinarily clear and beautiful way. I mean, you have to say, beautiful. There isn't a bad sentence in there.
The chapters tend to be quite short. They run in a chronological order over years of time, though, as the central character matures. And many of them end with a sentence or a final set of words, five or six words, that you could end the book there and say it was worth the price. But then, of course, you do read on because there is the suspense of the young mind seeking what has gone wrong? Why are they this way? Am I as strange as I think I am for worrying about what I worry about?
The Northern Renaissance, if we may so call it, has been distinguished more in poetry than, and I suppose to a lesser extent, in drama. And in poetry, I think, you can make the gesture of distance from the political and the social more easily, or at least with less incrimination, than you can in prose. And I think in some ways my own feeling about this novel, not even its success, just the novel itself, not that I'm not pleased by the success, but is that this novel actually is incriminated deeply by and in the political situation as it has emerged here over the last 50, 60 years. And yet at the same time, it is also a novel that, precisely because it's deliberately written in this sort of short, fragmentary, sort of vignette cameo style, is a novel which many people have said actually does approach to the condition of poetry now and again. And that is precisely what I wanted to get, both the distance that comes with poetry and also the incrimination that comes with prose narrative.
Anne, a great book by all accounts, but is it a good read?
It's a great read. He draws you in from the first page, and I love the way that his chapters are so tiny, page and a half to 2 pages each. They're really short, distilled, sharp bursts of emotion and description, beautifully written, beautiful, beautiful prose. And it's the impression that you have that you're getting a sort of an insight, like a child who's sitting looking down at the banisters, listening in to grown-ups talking about something they shouldn't hear about, or looking through a keyhole. You have that kind of almost a voyeuristic sort of a feeling about it that leads you on and on and on to the next secret and all the different layers.
There's a tremendous, actually, language of sensation in the novel, isn't there? I mean, there's a great perception of smells, of feelings that come from the child's point of view. Pat, what did you think about the talk of poetic language in it? I mean, did you read it with a poet's eye?
I suppose I did. I mean, I feel it is both. There are moments. I'm not sure I completely understand or agree with Seamus Dean's own kind of suggestion there that the poetry is a distancing. I don't know that it kind of falls into two camps like that. What I found about the book was the center of the story is this idea of the informer and the story that can or can't be told and the mystery. And the book is made up of stories within stories, like Russian dolls, if you like. And that's what I found fascinating. Some of those smaller base units, if you like, kind of came across as poems or as short stories, and others seem to contribute more directly into the overall narrative. And I liked the structuring of it. I thought was absolutely brilliant, and the way things that you got early in the story ignited later on and started to make sense in a new context.
They're not quite short stories, though. I mean, Anne, you're a short story writer. Did you feel that there was that self-enclosed thing that Jack Miles was talking about, or how did you look at them in terms of that short, sharp focus?
I think it worked very well. In the beginning, I thought, is this a collection of just short, sharp bursts? Does it hang together at all? But it all came together in a sort of a synthesis, like a jigsaw puzzle. But I think that the people in it were very, very real, and the story really drew you in and kept you moving. I wasn't too happy with the sort of resolution at the end. I felt there wasn't all that much resolution, and for that reason, the book as a whole didn't stay with me the way other books might have done. But definitely the language was absolutely mind-boggling. And because they were so short, I would find I would read a part and I'd just have to sit there, like eating a really good quality chocolate, you let it melt on your tongue. I had to just sit back and let it sink in, and sometimes I'd go back and reread it again almost immediately. It had that effect on me.
And it's the first novel, too, at the age of, 55, 56, 57, despite the fact that Dean is a very extensively published poet and a critic and, of course, editor of the very controversial Field Day anthology. I think we're still waiting for the section on women. When we actually look at that book, it's set in the Derry of the past, before the civil rights movement, before Eddie McAteer's nationalism even. Yes. Looking into that closed history, what did you get out of that, or did you feel it did anything for the present?
I think one of the most interesting things in the book for me is there's a line in it where he says, a Christian brother takes him in and gives him a lecture on sexuality, on his coming of age, if you like. And his suggested line in there is, love is in Latin, lust isn't. In other words, that there's a political line that all language has and takes. And I think what's extraordinary about the book is that he's managed to cover the nationalist political thing and the autobiographical thing, but to do it in a very readable way, to do it in a language that's immediately accessible. I think that's the revolution of the book.
Surprisingly accessible, actually, but of course, love in Latin, I mean, most of us can't do that. Let's move on to non-fiction work. Shortlisted books were A.T.Q. Stewart's The Summer Soldiers, a fascinating narrative about the 98 rebellion in the North. Brandon O'Buchla's Aisling Year, a lifetime's analysis of political Aisling poetry written in Irish. Now, two of the five judges were Irish language readers, but to be sure to be fair, prize administrator Gerard Kavanagh co-opted two more bilingual judges. Nonetheless, with his passionate post-colonial study of Irish writers inventing Ireland, the winner is Declan Kybird.
The Irish Risorgimento begins, astonishingly enough, with the figure of Oscar Wilde, who goes to England and sees that it is a country, a kind of fairyland, which he can conquer by an act of imagination and will. Many previous Irish writers have tried to explain to the English the implications of their own imperialism. Shahrún Cajan in Fearr's Fasar Éireann had done so, but in a book which, being written in Irish, would go unread in England. Edmund Burke had warned in many writings on his country about the dangers of the imperial adventure coming home to roost. But Wilde is really the first example of a major artist who decides that his mission must be to go to London and dismantle the imperial myth from within. Wilde is the first who seriously realizes that if he wishes to help invent Ireland, he must first of all go about the process of reinventing England.
I warmed slowly to Kybird's book when I began it with its sort of definitions of Irish literature setting itself up in opposition to and as a kind of non-reflecting mirror of English literature. I thought, oh dear, this is going to exhaust me. And then he is so clever, and he began to make, he weaves a kind of cobweb. It's not unlike Muldoon. He can connect anything and everything to anything and everything else. And he's like a juggler who throws lots and lots of little balls in the air and catches them all and puts them down next to another one, you suddenly see a different pattern.
I gave a lecture in 1984 in a series run by RTE. Six UCD lecturers were invited to do this. And mine was called Inventing Ireland. And I thought maybe a small book would be a development of the lecture, but 11 years passed and it grew and grew. And in the end, became Inventing Ireland in 1995.
And abolish the very notion of illegitimacy about 1,000 years before the idea struck young Fine Gael.
With his sharp intelligence, Wilde saw that the image of the stage Irishman tells us far more about English fears than about Irish realities. Just as the Irish joke revealed less about the Irishman's innate foolishness than about Englishmen's persistent and poignant desire once in their lifetimes to say something funny. Wilde opted to say that something funny for them in a lifelong performance of Englishness, which was a parody of the very notion. The ease with which Wilde effected the transition from stage Ireland to stage England was his ultimate comment on the shallowness of both categories.
I think it was again a mixture of wit at its very highest in the old 17th century sense that delighted us in Kybird. And we felt an immense respect for the amount he knows. He's obviously a man with a passionate love of literature. And he obviously has it all at his fingertips. And he can say, now, if this is so in Oscar Wilde, how does this relate to Seamus Heaney? Can I take it through Somerville and Ross? And by God, he always can.
I've always had a great love of words, and I suppose I grew up with the sense that the writer possessed dark and secret powers. You must remember, I went to school here in Clontarf, where one of my teachers was Donachoh Caolaher, one of the best short story writers in the modern language, and the other was John McGahern. And we all know what happened, how he lost his job in circumstances of controversy, which are not still totally clear. But one thing a young boy learned from all that was that the writer was possessed of secret social forces. And I remember later, when I came to read Portrait of the Artist by Joyce in my teens, coming down here to the Bull Wall and suddenly realizing that the main epiphany in that book, when he sees the girl wading in the water and looks out to sea and discovers his artistic vocation, actually happened on a spot that was very close to all our childhoods here in Clontarf.
in 1986, 2 years after the original lecture, I was running the Yeats Summer School, and I invited Edward Said to give a lecture on Yeats and the poetics of decolonization. And he did that, and he presented Yeats as one of the foremost poets of the decolonizing world, and a huge influence on people like Pablo Neruda, Darwish in the Middle East, and so on. It's interesting because Said argues that very often the energy expended in dislodging an occupier is so great that the people have no energy left with which to reimagine the national condition. The new regime created not industries so much as industrial authorities, not factories so much as fixers. Its schools remained obsessed with a hyper-academic form of learning derived from the colonial period, and this tested the new recruits for the swelling civil service. The curriculum tended to emphasize languages, not just English and Irish, but also Latin and Greek, resembling that of the English public schools in the mid-Victorian period. Science and technology tended to be treated as secondary. This ruling group mimicked the surface effects of consumerism, while its politicians bought votes at election time with borrowed cash. But it didn't build any infrastructure with which to service the debt. And the educators hardly bothered to conceal their snobbish contempt for those who actually made things with their hands.
All this post-colonial stuff, the Fs from Foucault to Friel to Fanon, did you feel that that was an important part of the book?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just put like that, it seems a little bit off-putting. I think the book is actually far more attractive, even though it does carry heavy 20th century ideas, if you like. It is that kind of Jungian, I prefer to see it in the kind of Jungian idea as the projection that Ireland is seen here as England's unconscious, if you like, and vice versa. So it's a little bit like the portrait in the Portrait of Dorian Gray that's hidden away in the attic and what's really happening there. And that the history of the islands and what happens between these two islands is a kind of, is again, to keep it Jungian, is or necessitates a kind of an integration. And the Act of Union of 1800 was kind of a fake attempt at that integration, where it was really, as seen in the book, it was really just a kind of a silencing of what might have been a revolutionary or a rebellious voice here.
But a lot of that stuff is, it's what A.S. Byatt calls oh dear words. I mean, the idea that, oh dear, he's post-colonialism, I'm going to be exhausted. But at the same time, it's quite a read. I mean, what do you think, Anne? Do you need to buy into the theory to enjoy the book?
Absolutely not. I mean, yeah. I think it's a great read. And the whole thing is that whether you agree with what he's saying or not, he makes you think. He makes you question and re-question and look at anew stuff that you might have taken for granted. Everybody knows their history about Ireland. Everybody knows all of these seminal writers and playwrights and so on. But he really makes their characters as such come alive. And you can see them in their historical and political and social context. The interchapters are a work of genius because each interchapter sets you up for what's happening around that time and really gives you a feeling for where they're coming from. And helps you place the whole thing. And he uses anecdote, and he goes into all the wonderful things that the people bitched and said about each other at the time, and all the backbiting and sniping. It's a really human, wonderful read, and you begin to relate to all of these authors as people in a way that I've never done before.
That whole nationalist thing, I mean, it's the polls again. It's like when Beckett was asked, did he carry an Irish passport, or an English passport rather, and said, au contraire. Did you feel that he stayed within those polls of Irishness and Englishness, or was he able to get out of it?
No, I think he was able to get out of it. I think one of the achievements of the book is to escape that tennis match. And one of the ways he did that, he looked at the post-colonial experience of other countries, particularly of India. He quotes Yeats in there at one stage as saying, until the Boyne, Ireland belonged to Asia. Yeats with his usual kind of exaggeration, but making a point that up until then, the language here connected us more to the outside world than we imagined. And that the one of the losses of the Boyne, the loss of the native language, which is something that's very close to him, precious to him in the book, that kind of isolated us more as an island, and therefore we tend to see the problem as being a problem of duality, but it may be that the solution is not in that duality, it's in something outside of it.
Yeah. And of course one of the things that distinguishes him is the fact that he can read as fluently in Irish as he can in English. Mm-hmm. But what about this post-traumatic shock we're all supposed to be going through because of the loss of the Irish language? I mean, do you think that's something that writers are actually aware of?
I don't think so. And I mean, it's certainly, like I said, he stirs up muddied waters and he makes you start to consider things. It's not something I would have considered, but I think it's a question. It's something I'm going to be considering from now on, and that's not a problem. But I must say, there were times when the sort of psychoanalysis of literature left me cold. Like there was a sort of an assertion at one stage that the setting up of the GAA was to counteract the feminization of the Irish male by the British. British, which had me absolutely gobsmacked, because I think, unfortunately, Irish men are not at all feminine. But so, I mean, sometimes I think really he was crushing something to fit his theory. But that being said, it's an absolute tour de force, and I couldn't fault it just because I disagree with parts of it. I think it's well worth reading.
But it's very much about invention, and that whole inventing Ireland theme is very much a theme of the Robinson years.
Yeah, and I mean the whole business of our post-colonial experience, our independence since independence, Ireland as the child, as Yeats' innocent child, and then how that child will grow up into a man, presumably, or a woman, and you know what that period will entail, and Yeats as the figure who is writing to discover the man as the child, really, that kind of innocence and the hope for a loss of innocence. That's part of the Robinson thing as well. That's the continuation between the two.
We did have a shot of Camogie there, and that may have been a young Mary McAleese actually in shot at that stage. Yeah. And that ability that you've mentioned about linking in the whole political and social context. I mean, Kybert is now professor of English literature in University College Dublin. Does this suggest to us that we're actually going to be looking at a new way of considering writing as a very fundamental part of the way we deal with the world?
Yeah, I should certainly hope so. I mean, one of the points he makes is that literature can be looked at. He talks about the tangled questions of identity. That literature, apart from just looking at politics and history and so on, that literature also has something to say, and that there are truths in literature. It's not the truth, because nothing contains the truth, but literature is just another aspect of it, and something that's been left out until now. And I think he's very much putting it centre stage. And the forward-looking end of the book I find extremely positive.
Well, let's go now to the Irish Literature Prize for Poetry, perhaps the toughest contest of them all, with powerful collections from Dublin-born Evan Boland and the Northern poet John Montague. Faced with such competition, A.S. Byatt's jury went for Savage Wit and that sting in the tail which is the signature of everything he writes. This year's winner, Paul Muldoon.
Symposium. You can bring a horse to water, but you can't make it hold its nose to the grindstone and hunt with the hounds. Every dog has a stitch in time. Two heads, you've been sold one good turn. One good turn deserves a bird in the hand. A bird in the hand is better than no bread. To have your cake is to pay Paul. Make hay while you can still hit the nail on the head. For want of a nail, the sky might fall. People in glass houses can't see the wood for the new broom. Rome wasn't built between two stools. Empty vessels wait for no man. A hair of the dog is a friend indeed. There's no fool like the fool who shot his bolt. There's no smoke after the horse is gone.
Reading the Muldoon poems was the greatest pleasure for me of the whole experience of the judging. It's because of, I think he has a kind of genius. I think he's a really original voice. He brings together words from disparate languages, words from popular American culture, words from popular British culture, words from ancient Irish culture, words from the North, words from the South. And then he weaves them into patterns where you have to take each of these words in two or three different ways. And suddenly, what looked like a kind of kaleidoscope of flying colors briefly focuses into one very powerful emotion or one very powerful thought, because he's a very thinking poet. He's elegant, he's a dandy, and there's a sort of tendency to accuse him of being too clever, as though being clever is a sin, which I find offensive as an idea. But he does do more than just be clever. I think he's going to go on and be one of the great poets of our time. I don't usually stick my neck out and say things like that about people.
The briefcase. I held the briefcase at arm's length from me. The ox blood or liver eel skin with which it was covered had suddenly grown supple. I'd been waiting in line for the crosstown bus when an almighty cloudburst left the sidewalk a raging torrent. And though it contained only the first inkling of this poem, I knew I daren't set the briefcase down to slap my pockets for an obol, for fear it might slink into a culvert and strike out along the East River for the sea, by which I mean the open sea.
High praise indeed, Anne, don't you think, from A.S. Byatt? I mean, are we talking about Ireland's next Nobel Prize winner?
I'm very nervous about the word genius, but I must agree that he has the sting in the tail, and sometimes his poetry can just, the sharpness of an image can just leave me absolutely floored. If I can just talk about something here, the Lass of Ockram, he talks about being in the Amazon and seeing an Indian boy playing a flute and recognising the tune as the Lass of Ockram. He hopes, Jesus explained, to charm the fish from the water on what was the tibia of a priest from a long abandoned mission. Something like that just stops me in my tracks, but I don't know, I think less is more here. His shorter, sharper poems, I think, cut through a lot better than the longer ones, some of which really leave me cold.
Yeah, I think A.S. Byatt makes a very interesting point there, the business of cleverness. The word clever, as applied to a writer in Ireland, is pejorative, and it's celebratory if it's applied by an English person to an Irish writer. I think that's something we have to get over, that clever is an impediment to his being taken as a good writer, and that he's not always serious, that he's playful. Playful is something that we're not supposed to be as writers as well. I have problems with the two of those things. I think a lot of Muldoon's poems appear on the page or in the world as a result of his playfulness with language. And Yeats would have said he made poems a bit like that as well. He made poems looking for the next rhyme, for instance. Muldoon will make poems looking for the next rhyme or trying to complete a structure. Sometimes something as well known, if you like, if not as simple as a sonnet. Sometimes something much more complex, like the long poem, some of which is represented here, Yarrow, 150 pages, which is made up of an incredibly complex, and in some ways, I presume, preordained rhyme scheme. So it's a little bit like Peter Greenaway's films, to an extent that it's kind of designed and then filled up, or that's how it seems. And Muldoon plays between the two of these things. Where he seems to be very often criticised is for not being overtly emotional, for not being on the line. But I think there's evidence of that happening in a poem like Incantata for Mary Farrell Powers.
Well, I'd like to come back to Incantata, but I mean, Healy in the Oxford lectures talked about the poet delighting in the process of poetry itself. Now, at a time when poets are under pressure to be accessible to everybody, Muldoon has no difficulty hopping into Greek classicism, hopping into Old English, whatever language. I mean, does that block the ordinary reader, or can they get it, or do they need to get it, or should they get it? I mean, does it have to be easy?
Yeah, no, Heaney has also said, though, that it's no denigration of a poem to say that it resists its audience for a time, that sometimes it's just going to take you a little while to find your way around the poem. And the poet is not always necessarily the best person to tell you what the poem is really about or how it came about. He or she might make it by accident.
But surely there's a pressure on poets and on writers generally to make the words into a kind of an MTV thing. And I think that's one of the things that Byatt is picking up on. That, like, he may be a prat, you may think he's a prat, because he makes you work. I mean, somebody tell me, what is an obol? I have no idea.
I think it's a curtailed obelisk myself, but that might be a different discussion.
Well, I think that there's possibly a ruder meaning, but let's not go into that. And language again. I mean, the role of language in literature is central, and again, it's something that's overlooked again and again. As a short story writer, you're very much into the short, sharp shock. What about the kind of focus that he gives to an image and the emotional truth Byatt talked about? Does he deliver that?
I think he does, and I think there's quite a lot of anger in some of his poems and a lot of emotional insight. And I can forgive him a lot because he just loves words so much that he might drag a whole lot of words screaming and kicking into a poem, and yet you will adopt them, you'll allow them to be there, you'll take them in like orphans who are left on your doorstep, because his enthusiasm for these words is just absolutely infectious, and suddenly they find themselves a place within the poem, I think. And I think he can certainly deliver a punch. And I mean, you know, you can talk about poems till the cows come home, but if it gives me something like a physical punch in the gut and I stop and go, ah, then it's worked, I think.
I think one of the strongest ways that came over for me was when he's looking at his mother's tombstone and her name is Reagan, and he reads it as anger.
He also tries to make a palindrome out of his own name as Hoodlum at one stage, but misses it by a letter. Yes. And it's those possibilities of play that for Muldoon are so interesting and that keep him occupied in in what is, I suppose, a solitary and sometimes quite a lonely occupation, that of writing, trying to make things in miniature.
The Hoodlum as well is a kind of, a response to the accusation that he is a prat.
Yeah.
And that comes
absolutely.
Up, that comes up in Incantata a lot.
He argues with himself all the time in the poems. He's all the time saying, but you can never get out there and say something.
There's an anthology for every taste, but is there a taste for every anthology? Undercover investigates at the same time next Thursday.